So we're here to solve the Slitherlink by Walker Anderson called zigzag frame. It starts through some of these diagonal threes that have a forced quick pattern, and there's actually more we can think about in this center set of ones. A three is always going to take one of these edges in, and it'll actually then take a straight channel through however it goes. So one of the options in the grid looks like this that I've drawn in red, and the other looks like this that I've drawn in blue. But notice we're always going to have one end that comes directly out of the center group, and the way the other side will do the same. And critically for how we've been marking the rest of the grid in, we're not going to take the extremes of the ones. The one will be fulfilled by some central edges. And in doing that, we'll see that we have to actually mark off these. Notice that if we did come through those, we would sort of form these closed loops too soon. So some of the look ahead to set up the star of the grid is marking in these spaces. The other space we're going to do some quick progress is around these diagonal threes. They're going to lead to an edge that's going to be either the top or right of this one, but there's always going to be an edge coming out from that vertex, and there'll always be an edge coming out from this vertex. So those are some of the ways to get started. The next thing I'm seeing, and there are a few, I think these diagonal ones are somewhat constrained, but I think these two ones along the edge that surround another clue look like a fairly constrained space. And one of the reasons I'm saying that those look constrained, let me come back to sort of some coloring. Let's imagine I take an edge like this one. I then mark all of these edges around as impossible. And in marking those as impossible, I mark this as impossible. And then in coming back to marking in edges, I would now have to fulfill this too, but take an edge that now can't get any further out from the grid. And so this would quickly cause a contradiction I can't work around. And so these extremes of the ones look bad. But it's even the case if we go to like this edge, this also looks bad because of the same reason. It's going to mark off these around the two quickly, and the two's going to have to come in here and again not have a space to go. So around this pattern, the left and right sort of these extreme edges as well as the top edges cause an issue. Coming through the bottom is fine, and we're going to see that we have to take this bottom edge here, and we've got some options around the one for how we fill in the rest, but in marking off these diagonal cells, we actually now have this pattern where this is effectively a zero near a two. This two is going to take either these edges or these edges, but it will always come down and over. And in doing that, we now can think through how do we get a valid set of ways to fill in this two with these adjacent twos. And one thing that we can look at, probably this clue here is the one that's a little more constrained. We need to get two of its edges taken. There are a few ways that can go. Notice that if this edge isn't taken, that looks like the most constraining, in part because it's going to quickly put in this kind of pattern. This two and this two quickly force themselves, but we actually isolate an end in the grid with that pattern. And so some look ahead down here suggests I always have to take this rightmost edge. And there are two kinds of options. We could sort of do this, which looks good, or we can do this, which looks good. But the parity of these clues together, I mean, this two and this two means we take this right edge. That actually comes over here. It finishes out this two. This extends out. This extends like this. I'm not coming up here because that would close off a loop. So instead, I'm coming over to the top. I do take this pattern that finishes out this three with this two. Come up here. One thing with this edge coming into a 2 is that now I know out of the diagonally opposite side of this 2 an edge is coming out here, and I can keep that chain going all the way up to this 2 where I need an edge coming up or to the right out of this vertex, and there's no way to go up, so I have to go to the right. That puts in this connection to the 3 and starts to now limit the space around this 2. And so this 2 clue will either have this top edge with an edge coming here or have this right edge with an edge coming here, but this first edge coming out of the 2, something we can mark in. I now want to think about how do I fulfill the rest of the space around these clues. And all of these adjoining twos look like they're going to have some parity constraints that pop up. And sometimes the easiest way to see these is to actually just put in some of the deductions in the grid and follow them through. The first edge I'm going to look at is this right one here. And the reason I'm going to do that is it actually quickly marks off all these edges around this clue is now unusable. And in putting this around this too, I get this clue that I can fulfill with this, but I'm now isolating a loop end. And so one of the edges we can't take is this one, and that puts this into the grid. Another potential parity constraint is going to be, my guess is taking this bottom clue, and the reason that's going to be bad is it's going to quickly form this pair. So if I come over here, again, that marks this as unused, this comes through, this comes in, and now this still looks okay so far, but now we have a single edge we've got to take, and we have to come in and out of the space, and so this forms a three on this corner. And again, the parity rules don't let that work, and so this edge in the bottom of this two isn't possible. We have to take these and put this into the grid. And this looks like the only pattern we can take, but there's even more we can do pretty quickly off of it. If I come in, for instance, take this bottom edge, you'll quickly be able to see that we now close off the loop. So again, some look ahead here, we've got to take the right edge instead. That comes up here. This two has to go like this. That two comes down the space. And so we got the start of the upper right of the grid. We're gonna come back to the top. This end has to keep extending. These ends have to dodge. This end doesn't want to come in here because it's going to have to keep dodging. So we put these into the grid. We got these ends coming through. This two is coming and taking that edge. Notice with this corner marked off, these are marked off, which means these are marked off. So this has to come into the space. And now we have a fact that we can only get as many as one more end into the upper left corner, but we always already have two ends up here. So I'm really not coming across this space. I'm instead just filling the space. And that means to actually reach this one clue, these have to keep dodging, but where we can't come into this corner, they come like this. So that all looks okay. This top group of the loop doesn't want to close on itself, so these come down and still doesn't want to close on itself, so this comes across. Notice we're now in a space where, and let me erase these ends we have in the grid. I guess I'll do it this way. We have a space where the blue option was reaching a single end into the space that wasn't going to work anymore. So instead, we always now have to have red be true. And in marking that in, we get this path through the grid. We've got this diagonal three we can now do more with. This comes to the right and top. This comes over and down. We now effectively have a big part of the loop on the left side of the grid. And as we actually look through some of these things, notice that around this two clue, whether we take this right edge or this top edge, we always come up here. And now that we see that, what we actually have is a case where this end and this end will always connect. They may not connect directly, they may sort of have a longer path, but if these connect, that means that the opening for the rest of this loop has to be through the bottom. So this has to come over, and this comes up, and then again, so now these ends did connect, but they're reaching out in this way. We can't come all the way over to the zero, so this has to come through. This end and this end still need to stay apart, so notice why this is bad, is why we have to take this other option. This end now still dodges around the zero, comes up here. We've got this end starting out. We're completing these two clues, but we need to keep this open and apart to join the rest of the loop end. So we finished this puzzle, a very tricky one from Walker, and had some different uses of parity and other constraints in the grid. I definitely found this 1-2-1 pattern to be one of the more constraining spots to just do some look ahead, and that got me started, getting me through the grid, diagonal connectivity in the upper right, then had this last part, all these twos together, had a lot of constraints which forced the rest of the grid and forced us into the remaining spots. So some different ways I looked through the puzzle. There are probably your own ways you might have discovered that are related, but the kind of parity of vertices and even parity around even clues look pretty key for the solve. So I hope you learned something through this video, and we'll see you again soon.